Hello, I am Dr. Swati Shiradkar, working as professor in obstetrics and gynecology in MGM Medical College, Aurangabad under MGM IHS. Today, we are going to see management of dysfunctional uterine bleeding or DUB. This condition DUB, it can be defined as spectrum of menstrual irregularities where there is no obvious cause detected by examination or investigation. Before we go for this condition, we must understand that how the menstrual pattern is governed. It is called as HPO axis or hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis. The environment around us, it controls the cerebral cortex. The cerebral cortex in turn gives the signal to hypothalamus. Hypothalamus then releases the gonadotropin releasing hormones. They act on anterior pituitary. This anterior pituitary first secretes the follicle stimulating hormone, which will stimulate the ovary, and one of the dormant follicles will start growing. This follicle, the cells around the follicle, they will secrete estrogen, and because of that, there will be negative feedback for follicle stimulating hormone. As the levels of estrogen, they go on rising, there will be LH or luteinotropin hormone surge. And this surge leads to an event in ovary, which is called as ovulation or release of the follicle out of the ovary. After ovulation, the remaining part of the follicle is called as corpus luteum. This corpus luteum goes on secreting estrogen as well as progesterone. But the life of corpus luteum is limited. In absence of pregnancy or fertilization, the corpus luteum dies. In turn, there is loss of estrogen and progesterone secreting cells. The levels of estrogen progesterone, they fall, and then there is positive feedback to the pituitary in form of releasing of the follicle stimulating hormone. Now in this slide, you can see the diagrammatic representation of this HPO axis, that the follicle stimulating hormone levels, they start before the menstruation. And because of that, the growth of next follicle already starts. Menstruation is the result of unfertilized ovum in a previous cycle. The events in this cycle, they start with regeneration, and this regeneration is result of secretion of estrogen. Now here we can see that in first half of the cycle, there is almost no luteinizing hormone or progesterone. The estrogen rises, the peak of estrogen releases LH. LH causes ovulation. After ovulation, there is again secretion of estrogen and more amount of progesterone. As the corpus luteum dies, both levels of estrogen and progesterone, they fall. What happens in normal menstruation? The frequency of cycle is governed by timing of ovulation. If the ovulation occurs before 14 days, then the cycle is frequent. If the ovulation is after 14 days, the cycle will be delayed. If there is no ovulation, then there is no prediction when cycle will come. The amount and flow is decided on the local events taking place into the endometrium, and they are in two forms. Two types of prostaglandins are secreted. PGF2 alpha is vasoconstrictor, while PGE2 is vasodilatation. The balance between two will maintain or will cause the menstruation, will control the bleeding, and then the flow is decided on that. First of all, there will be platelet aggregation and fibrin formation to control the bleeding. Then there is vasoconstriction. And finally, the bleeding stops because there is regeneration of the cells which are shed because of new follicle secreting estrogen. We have seen about normal menstruation. But what happens, why the menstrual pattern differs, or what are the different presentations? Previously, we used to use different words. In this slide, I have mentioned both the words which are used now and which were used conventionally previously. First is amenorrhea. We call it absence of menstruation. Then menorrhagia. Now it is termed as heavy menstrual bleeding. When the frequency is altered, that is, there is polymenorrhagia. Now it is called as frequent menstrual bleeding. If the menstrual bleeding is infrequent, previously we used to call it as oligomenorrhea. If the bleeding amount is less, now it is called as light menstrual bleeding. It is not necessary that the patient will present with single symptom. There can be combination of symptoms which we can find in a single patient. Also, there can be a irregular bleeding where the menstrual pattern is not at all maintained. So now we should be able to designate the symptom which is self-justifying, that what exactly is happening either in the ovary or into the endometrium. The DUB is subclass of abnormal uterine bleeding. So whenever there is a bleeding through the uterus which is about because of the menstruation, it is usually in a normal pattern or it is a pattern set for that lady. But when there is disturbance in that pattern, we call it a abnormal uterine bleeding. And this abnormal uterine bleeding can be because of some structural abnormality, because of some abnormality in the function of the uterus. So abnormal uterine bleeding can be because of pregnancy. It can be because of new growths like fibroid. It can be because of malignancies, but it can be because of DUB also, that is dysfunctional uterine bleeding. We classify this as the primary DUB, where the problem is mainly in the ovary or in the endometrium, and secondary DUB, where the problem in endometrium or ovary is because of something else or the external factor. So today we are going to see the management of this small classification, that is primary or secondary DUB. Nowadays we are using a Palm-Cohen classification where the abnormal uterine bleeding is classified according to its origin, and this DUB is classified as the AUBE or AUBO. Now we will see what is the pathophysiology of DUB. We have seen that usually it is because of problem in the endometrium, which can be primary in the endometrium or secondary because of the ovarian action. So usually there is balance between vasoconstrictors and vasodilators. If this balance is deranged, then there can be excessive bleeding or the pattern of bleeding can change. Also, there can be a fibrin degeneration which is excessive, or the endometrial thickness is so large that the large amount of endometrium will undergo necrosis, or there can be fault in the regeneration, or there can be fault in shedding as well. Because of any of these imbalances, there we can find that various symptoms of menstrual irregularities can be observed. The diagnosis of DUB, as it is defined, that absence of any obvious clinical pathology. So the diagnosis is usually by exclusion. The history over here is very important, because so many times patients, they come to us with irregular pattern and we will find that they are taking hormones from somewhere else. Once they stop bleeding, they will stop the hormone medication as well. So careful history is very important. There may be pregnancy. We want to know what is the previous pattern of that particular lady. So the history is having major role in making the diagnosis of DUB. Careful examination aiming at finding some abnormality which will rule out DUB, or we will know what is the cause of DUB over here. Then after that, the role of investigations come. Usually ultrasonography is a gold standard for ruling out any pathology, knowing abnormality into the ovary as well as in the endometrium. But sometimes it is not sufficient, and we may have to go for hysteroscopy, we may have to go for biopsy of the endometrium, or we may have to undertake the hormone assays. The success of management in DUB, it depends how we select the patient, what type of management we select, And unless until our selection of patient and modality of the treatment is correct, the success will not be there. When we are advising that the patient is supposed to undergo ultrasonography, we prefer that we can have a premenstrual ultrasonography so that we can come to know, is there any endometrial hyperplasia, what kind of endometrium it is, the thickness of endometrium, any abnormal ovarian pathology, is there any increased vascularity, any other pathology which will rule out the diagnosis of DUB and we can find out the cause. So ultrasonography is the basic investigation we will do to diagnose DUB or to rule out DUB. Hysteroscopy is not required in all the patients. When we find that there is no obvious pathology, the pattern is maintained but irregular bleeding is there or very heavy bleeding is there. If we are suspecting any malignancy, if we have given the medical management, it has failed and now we want to diagnose that are we missing anything in diagnosis of DUB. So only in selected cases we will advise that the hysteroscopy is to be done. The role of biopsy is usually in perimenopausal age group, that is the patients who are beyond or around 40 years of the age till menopause. We are not considering here the bleeding after menopause because the postmenopausal bleeding, the biopsy is must. Here, as we are considering DUB, it is a disease of reproductive system. So, when the patient is around 40 years or beyond and patient is complaining of some abnormality into her menstrual pattern which has changed, then it is usually indicated that we should do a biopsy. This biopsy is to be done in again premenstrual phase. Why? Because we want to know whether the proliferation has taken place, whether the proliferation is excessive, whether the ovulation has taken place, is there any other abnormality into the endometrium? And we will not find answers to this question if we do the biopsy, that is DNC or endometrial sampling, in other parts of the menstrual cycle apart from premenstrual phase. But sometimes patients come to us that there is no guarantee when the menstruation will start, so we don't know when there is a premenstrual phase. In such cases, we can do this DNC and we can still obtain the endometrial sample within 8 hours of starting of the menstruation. So such instructions need to be given to the patient when we want to do a endometrial sampling. What kind of endometrial reports we can get? We may get that it is a secretory endometrium. As we are doing it in a premenstrual phase, it is absolutely normal. But we may get a proliferative endometrium, which is abnormal in this part of the cycle. We may just get a necrotic endometrium. We may get atrophic endometrium, or we may get a sign of malignancy as well. Nowadays, this endometrial pathology is classified as proliferative secretory, that is without hyperplasia. But whenever there is hyperplasia, the classification is done as simple hyperplasia when there is only proliferation. Complex hyperplasia when there is excessive proliferation but the ovulation has taken place. And atypical hyperplasia where the cells are showing atypia, that is they may be precancerous cells or cancerous cells. And of course we may get a malignant pattern as well. Now, what are the modalities of treatment available to deal with this condition, that is dysfunctional uterine bleeding? As we have already seen that this is a disease of reproductive age group. Naturally, our first aim is to preserve the uterus. So, whenever there is DUB, the choice of hysterectomy is last. We have to start with medical management. This medical management can be hormonal or it can be non-hormonal. The medical management itself can be given only locally in form of intrauterine devices. We may go for certain conservative surgeries where we burn the endometrium or we remove the endometrium. In very rare cases, or if the medical management fails, then we may go for hysterectomy. In certain cases, to stop the bleeding or to achieve the menopause, we may use radiation in very rarely. Now, when I am telling that our first choice is medical management, what is goal of this medical management? Of course, the final goal is we want to reverse the abnormality into the endometrium so that the flow amount of flow and the cycle frequency will be restored. But sometimes this goal is a long-term goal. The primary goal may be achieving the blood control of bleeding if the patient is coming in the acute phase, or if we are preparing patient for ablation, that is removal of the endometrium, then if we want to prepare endometrium for this ablation, we may give a short course of hormones or the medical management. Now, what are the modalities available in medical management? First, we will see non-hormonal, that is NSAIDs. They act as anti-prostaglandins and they may correct the abnormality into the balance of prostaglandins, or there may be antifibrinolytics. As the excessive fibrinolysis causes excessive bleeding, if we correct this excessive fibrinolysis, we can control the bleeding. Or we can use combination of estrogen and progesterone in form of oral contraceptive pills. We may use progestins only in various forms, that is oral, injectable, local or implants. We can use other drugs like dinazole or GnRH analogs also as a part of medical management. When we are considering patient for medical management, there are certain variables which we must consider when we are deciding that which form of medical management will be most suited to this patient. So in this, the first variable will be age of the patient. Here, we are not just telling age in years, but we are grading her in a scale. The scale is according to the phase of that lady's cycle. Is she in reproductive phase, that is minus 4, 5 or 3? If she is in perimenopause, she is minus 2, minus 1. If she has attended her last menstrual period, which is very difficult to note prospectively, because unless and until she stops bleeding for 1 year, we will not term that period as a last period, but that will be stage 0. Then there is a stage which is called as early menopause, that is she has just stopped, or she has just 1 year back she has stopped getting menses. But there can be a lady who is having menopause many years back. Now here, the ladies who are in plus stage, that is post-menopause, will not be considered for DUB, as it is a disease of reproductive age group. So we are concerned up to stage 0. But age is very important variable when we are choosing the medical management. The other variables to be considered when we are choosing a medical management are whether patient needs contraception because she is in the reproductive age group. What is patient's compliance? Because the hormonal management success 50% is in hands of patient. If she is non-compliant, then there will be recurrence of this condition. Of course, in investigation, if we suspect that there is any precancerous condition which may lead to genital malignancies, or there is a malignancy already, even though she is in the reproductive age group, then of course she is not fit for a medical management. Now, oral contraceptive pills, they are usually combined oral contraceptive pills. They contain estrogen as well as progesterone. Their role is limited for certain conditions. While progestins, they form very important part of management of DUB in form of medical management. What are these progestins? They are actually progesterones, but they are synthetic one. The synthetic one are called as progestins. The natural is progesterone. Why they are called as progestins? Because they may not have all actions like progesterone. These synthetic progestins, they can be derivatives of progesterone only, where there is very minimal androgenic activity. If they are testosterone derivatives, then we will find that there can be the androgenic activities present. and there are spironolactone derivatives as well. As we all know that if the cycle is ovulatory, that is progesterone is in action, then the bleeding is controlled, the frequency as well as amount. And if the cycle is unovulatory, then it can be uncontrolled. So what is action of progesterone or progestins on endometrium which will control this bleeding? This action is on DNA where the proliferation is prevented. There can be the action to reduce the estrogen receptors. The balance between prostaglandins is maintained. There is stability to the cell matrix. And somehow we have seen that whenever there is a progesterone withdrawal, the bleeding is under control, because the premenstrual shedding or postmenstrual spotting also can be governed or can be treated by progestins. That means these progestins also have some regenerative action if there is irregular shedding or ripening of the endometrium. Now we are coming to actual management case by case. Commonly what we get is when the menarche starts, the girl, she is having irregularity into the cycle. Either cycles are very frequent or cycles are prolonged. If there is bleeding, the bleeding doesn't stop and the girl will suffer from anemia. That condition is known as puberty menorrhagia. All puberty menorrhagias are not polycystic ovarian diseases. It is just an anovulation. Why? Because the balance or the HPO axis is not yet mature. So the estrogenic action has started, but the progesteronic action is not yet there. What we find over here is the cycle is usually anovulatory. There is unopposed growth in the endometrium, that is proliferation, and that is why the shedding of endometrium is irregular and there is excessive bleeding. Naturally, we don't want to interfere with this HPO axis because it is taking time to get mature. If we interfere, then this natural process can be disturbed. So what we do is, we just replace the progesterone which was supposed to be there in her cycles from day 14 for 10 days. Because usually day 14 is a day of ovulation, and after that the progesterone comes into the cycle, into the circulation. So we just give a progesterone. What is the choice of progesterone? We should prefer over here the least androgenic and progesterone derivatives. Why? Because the androgenic action will again have disturbance into the maturation of HPO axis. Just a treatment for 3 to 4 cycles will be sufficient for her. In case the condition repeats, we can give this progesterone only in the second half of the cycle, even for a year also. Now there is a condition which is called as PCO, polycystic ovary. When there is a one more letter is there, S or D, it suggests syndrome or disease. When we are diagnosing on USG, it is PCO, that is anovulation. But if we want to diagnose PCOS or PCOD, then we need to have certain other additional criteria to be fulfilled in form of reversal of FSH and LH ratio in a immediately post-menstrual phase, or there is increase in AMH, or there is insulin resistance, and we must prove that there is anovulation. Now this condition, it is necessary that we must treat. Usually patient presents with irregular or infrequent cycles. The cycles can be heavy or cycles may be very light. She may have a weight gain or she may be just lean. Why we want to treat this? Because polycystic ovarian disease, if it is left untreated, not only it will cause infertility, but it can cause metabolic disorders later in life. So it is very important that we should diagnose polycystic ovarian syndrome properly. So when patient comes to us with some irregularities into the menstrual pattern and we are suspecting that she is maybe having PCOS, when she is having hirsutism, she may be obese. Usually the condition starts few years after menarche. So before that, after menarche, for few years the cycles are regular, and now the irregularity has shown in. The confirmation is usually by hormone assays. And what is the treatment? We know that there is excessive LH secretion, and that is why there is no FSH secretion, there is no dominant follicle which is taking place, and there is abnormality into the ovulation. So what is the treatment? We have to just suppress the HPO axis for long, that is 6 months to 1 year, which will prevent unnecessary proliferation, which will prevent or which will cause the dying of the subcentrimetric follicles which are there. Many follicles are there which will give the pattern, necklace like pattern on ultrasonography. So we have to give suppression of HPO axis. Then what is preferred over here? Naturally, the combination of estrogen and progesterone. Why? Because we are giving controlled doses of estrogen. And when she is having PCO, the estrogen levels are high, even though that estrogen may not be active to cause proliferation into the endometrium. So we usually prefer either cyproterone acetate as a progesterone, or the drosperinone, that is spironolactone derivative, as a progesterone in oral contraceptive pills. Now we will come to some conditions, because in extremes of the age of reproductive age, that is the during puberty or young age, usually we find puberty menorrhagia, or we find that there is PCOS. When the patient passes that age and she is actually reproducing or she is having some children, at that time also there may be condition where she simulates DUB, that there is no obvious pathology, but usually it is mild infection, usually the frequency is affected, or if the duration is affected, it can be secondary, like the thyroid disorder, that is hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism. There may be anemia as a cause and result as well. In such area or in such age, usually she prefers contraception. So if we do ultrasonography and we find out that there is no obvious pathology into the uterus or the ovary, we may just start the oral contraceptive pills, and the cycle frequency as well as flow will be recovered, or she will have relief from the condition. If of course there is a thyroid disorder, we have to correct the disorder. But when the patient is nearing menopause, or she is in a perimenopausal age group, what we call as, in that case it is mandatory that we should obtain a biopsy. Usually these patients, they present with menorrhagia or heavy menstrual bleeding. They may present with heavy and frequent bleeding as well. When we do DNC, we find out various parts, various types of endometrium. If we find out that there is a proliferative endometrium, that means there is a anovulation. The proliferative endometrium without hyperplasia can well be treated by just progesterones in the second half of the cycle. Or if patient wants contraception, then we may give her oral contraceptive pills as well. This we can do when there is no hyperplasia and there is just a proliferation or absence of ovulation. If we find out that there is a secretory endometrium, so giving progesterone only in second half will not be sufficient. In this case, the choice remains as a oral contraceptive pills. So we have seen that there can be endometrium which is proliferative or secretory. If it is secretory, we may be missing some cause which is outside the endometrium or ovary, like hypothyroidism. Or we can just try the non-hormonal methods. But if non-hormonal methods, they fail, then we have to give oral contraceptive pills when it is secretory. But when it is proliferative, we are having choice to give progestins for total cycle. We are having choice to give progestins in second half of the cycle, or we can give oral contraceptive pills. When we use the progestins which are testosterone derivatives like norethisterone or other progestins, the cycle control is better. But if the age advances, then here the spironolactone derivative progestins, they are of choice even though we are using it in oral contraceptive pills. In such cases, the dose of estrogen also matters. So we must prefer the low dose or very low dose estrogen pills. If we increase the dose of estrogen, then the complications of estrogen in this age are very high. So secretory endometrium and proliferative endometrium, usually there is no problem with the ovulation, but the problem is at local level and which can very well be corrected by the NSAIDs, by antifibrinolytics or by oral contraceptive pills or by progestins. Sometimes we do DNC and we find out that there is simple or complex hyperplasia without ATPia. Why there is hyperplasia? Previously we used to call these patients as metropathia hemorrhagica. That is, the patient is having amenorrhea for 2 to 3 months, then she bleeds, and when we find out that there is hyperplasia. What happens usually over here, the rate of rise of estrogen is very low, and that is why there is no sufficient inhibition of FSH, neither there is LH surge. So there is anovulation, there is low rise of estrogen till the granular cells they die, and then the estrogen levels they fall. And because it is a estrogen withdrawal bleeding, the estrogen withdrawal bleeding, endometrium is very unstable. The proliferation causes excess necrosis and there will be excessive bleeding. This bleeding may be infrequent or it may be on the time as well. What is the treatment choice? Here, it is not sufficient to give progesterone only in second half. We have to prevent proliferation when it starts. That is why either we have to give the oral contraceptive pills where we are giving progesterone from starting, that is first tablet. So progesterone is having anti-proliferative action and the proliferation will be prevented. Or we can give only progesterone, but here we have to start from 5th day of the cycle and then we have to continue the treatment for 21 days. The duration of treatment is also prolonged, 8 cycles to 12 cycles. There are other choices also, because we know that if continuously we provide progesterone, there will be loss of proliferation. So we can here use the intrauterine contraceptives which will release progesterone locally. We may use implants, we may use injections. There are various options also over here, because it is a simple or complex hyperplasia, but it is without ATPia. Sometimes patient present with premenstrual spotting or they present with postmenstrual spotting. If on ultrasonography we find out there is no abnormality into the thickness of endometrium or echogenicity of the endometrium, then there may not be any need to do biopsy. We can just give progesterones because we find out that there is a corpus luteal defect or deficiency of corpus luteum. If we provide the progesterone, that is secretion of corpus luteum, in second half of the cycle, whether it is a premenstrual spotting or postmenstrual spotting, for 3 to 6 cycles, the condition will be cured. We know that finally the menstrual bleeding stops because of regeneration. For regeneration, the basal endometrium needs to be normal and active, and there has to be stimulation in form of estrogen. If it is not there, then we find condition which is called as atrophic endometrium. This atrophic endometrium cannot control the bleeding well and it continues for a prolonged period. In this condition, giving only progesterone may not be helpful. So we have to give the oral contraceptive pill, which is combination of estrogen and progesterone, or we can give estrogen alone for first cycle and add the progesterone to it for first half, and in second half we can give progesterone along with estrogen. We have talked about other options in medical management, that is dinazole or GnRH analogs. They are used in very severe bleeding when the bleeding is not responding to routine management even after increasing dose of progestins, or we want to prepare the endometrium for ablation, because dinazole and GnRH analogs, they will reduce vascularity in the endometrium and the endometrial ablation will be an easy procedure. What is the role of endometrial ablation? When we want to preserve uterus, but we want to treat the DUB and we see that there is failure of medical management or patient's compliance is not there or patient is unfit to take a medical management, we may post patient for endometrial ablation. Here we have to know that there is no ERTPA, because ERTPA is a precancerous condition and conservation of uterus in perimenopausal age group is not indicated. But once we exclude ERTPA, at that time we can consider the endometrial ablation. We have to counsel patient that we are trying to conserve the uterus, but it may not be always possible and we may end up doing hysterectomy as well. We also have to tell her that there are chances that the endometrium can regenerate because her ovaries are functioning and the condition can recur even though rarely. And also, endometrial ablation is a surgical procedure, so patient needs to be fit for surgical treatment. Thank you very much.